Each family had one room. Didn't matter how many children you had in the family. We were lucky there were only three of us kids, so five of us fit into one room. And if you had four, five, six children, tough luck, you managed in this one room. And when we were put in concentration camps, every family was given a number. And from then on, we were numbers, not names. And we said, why are you putting us in a concentration camp? And they said, for your protection. I told Mom and Dad, I said, you're Japanese, we're Japanese Americans. Well, what they meant was any Japanese, whether you're Japanese Americans or not. There's a word in Japanese, Ganbare, which means get going or gung-ho. You say, Ganbare, Ganbare. No, don't give up. Hang in there. That my grandma made millions in the stock market, which suddenly put them up in the upper class. My mother was born and raised in Tokyo, by the way. And as I said, my grandma was very progressive. And you know, only with a sixth grade education, she decided that five of her children are going to be different. Number one, Mom was the oldest, and she decided to send her to a Christian school, believe it or not. All the faculty were white-haired, Caucasian, retired missionaries. So from day one, they spoke English. And Mom said she could still remember sneaking in the book in the chapel. They had to go to chapel every morning. And reading these love novels while the sermon was going on. And she was caught doing that and punished severely. My dad came over to the United States when he was 17. And I said, well, how did you get into the country? Well, in those days, the Japanese government will only give you a passport to go to Mexico or Canada. So you go to Mexico, Canada, and then you snuck into the United States. And I told my dad, I said, how did you sneak in? Didn't they stop you? They said, no, good luck. Simply, but there was a reason for letting the Chinese and the Japanese sneak in. As today, there were a lot of jobs that Americans didn't want. So these illegal immigrants got the jobs that the Americans scorned, so they were welcome. Those are the days when the Japanese came as immigrants, and you notice the American flag, they were proud to be Americans, always American flag next to the Japanese flag. You've heard of picture wives? Well, what the guys did, my dad went to Japan and was looking for a bride, and he said he was a farmer. So, but my mom's mother, my grandmother, changed it to a rich farmer. Not just a plain farmer, he was just a scrabbly old farmhand was what he was. But by my grandmother saying rich, then she decided her daughter was going to marry a rich farmer. So Mom said she visioned herself going to the Japanese embassy ball and going to cocktail parties. So she bought huge suitcases full of beautiful Japanese kimono. A lot of them were embroidered in silver and gold. So she said she landed in San Francisco, and from San Francisco to LA took a train. And then in LA, there was a rickety old car, you know, the kind that were opened back in the early 1900s. And she said, her husband told her they were going south. And she noticed after a while that it was all desert around her.
So that was
my dad was farming in the Mojave Desert. So then finally the car stopped, and she said, what's in the middle of the desert? So she said, what happened? Did the car break down? And my dad said, no. I live just down the road there. And what he took her to was a wooden shack. She thought it was a storage. It was her house. Until she died, she was angry about it. I was born in a desert town called El Centro, California. And this is the El Centro Christian Church. And my mother was very active, having graduated from a Christian college in Japan. And here I am. I think I was 2 years old. My dad started a Chinese restaurant, of all things, back in El Centro. He did very well. Everything was going fine until Pearl Harbor.
December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy. The United States of America was suddenly and deliberately attacked.
Well, we were all shocked when the Japanese bombed Pearl Harbor. And the very next day, there was a big sign all over town saying, Japanese citizens are under curfew and you cannot leave the house after 8 o'clock. I told Mom and Dad, I said, you're Japanese, we're Japanese Americans. Well, what they meant was any Japanese, whether you're Japanese Americans or not. Fortunately, I was able to graduate from Brawley Union High School. Graduation was in May, and we were sent to the concentration camp in May. So I was told I was a valedictorian. So I went to the principal and said, well, you know, could I make my speech earlier? And he said, no, tough luck, but good luck in your camp. So that was the end of that. And everyone could take only one suitcase, nothing else, one suitcase per person. We had a restaurant then. My dad was glad to sell a huge refrigerator for $5. And all of the other kitchen utensils, can you imagine the restaurant? People bought it for like 25 cents, 50 cents. We had to sell everything. And things we couldn't carry, we had to store. And naturally, as soon as we were gone, they were all looted. So we lost everything. And we said, why are you putting us in a concentration camp? And they said, for your protection. In the middle of the desert, these armed guards were protecting us with rifle. And I remember they had bayonets. It says Colorado River Relocation Center. They didn't call it concentration camp. They had this real nice name calling Relocation Center. And each family had one room. It didn't matter how many children you had in the family. We were lucky. There were only three of us kids. So five of us fit into one room. And if you had four, five, six children, tough luck. You managed in this one room. So anyway, when we went into our assigned room, we saw army cots, you know, this narrow, but no mattress. But there were canvas bags around. That didn't occur to me that there were a pile of hay outside. And we were to stuff this canvas bag and make our own mattress. Once we were stuck in camp, we were assigned various jobs. My dad would be a cook. I would be a nurse's aide. My mom would be a seamstress, and they assigned us. And needless to say, there were a lot of doctors and attorneys who were practicing in LA, who were wealthy. But the government decided the highest wages you could get was $18 a month. So the doctors, attorneys, all the professionals got 18. But we were lowly workers. But we did get something like $8-$10 a month working 40 hours a week. And we were glad to get that. Every family was given a number. And from then on, we were numbers, not names. So we were number 33525. My dad had to register for the Army. I thought that was a little bizarre. You know, we'll put you in a concentration camp, but in the meantime, you have to register for the Army. Would you believe that the Army came into the concentration camp to recruit soldiers to die for your country? Guess who did that? My husband was one of the first to volunteer. Hundreds of guys, and he's 18 here, volunteered from, there were 10 camps, by the way, 10 concentration camps, all over the United States. And they had enough volunteers to make this special 442nd Combat Infantry Regiment. They got the most presidential citation in World War II. He was wounded about 3 times, and he got Purple Heart, and he got the Oak Leaf Cluster, the Bronze Medal. He got all kinds of medal for being a hero. When he was in basic training in Mississippi, he had a, what they call R&R, rest and recreation, and he came up, and I can't remember because I was engaged at that time. Somebody decided that I was going to take care of him, go out on a date, and I said, no, I can't, you know, I'm engaged, you know. Well, this girl said, well, nobody will know the difference. I said, well, okay, then. Well, to make a long story short, when he got back from the war, then we got married, yes. After we were in the concentration camp about a year, somebody decided that maybe it was against the law because we weren't charged in court. Washington, D.C. Supreme Court said, yeah, I think it's against the law to throw in American citizen concentration camp. So then they decided we American citizens had to leave camp, but our parents couldn't get out. Plus, we could not go back home to the West Coast. None of us. We had to all go east. Well, my two brothers and I, we didn't know where to go. You know, we other than Brawley, California, Mojave Desert, we didn't know the United States. So we said, well, let's take out a map of the United States to decide where we're going. So we looked and we said, you know, let's go to the city that has the biggest print on the map. That's the criteria. So we looked at the map and New York was the biggest print. But we heard bad things that it was dangerous. So the next big print was Chicago. From this concentration camp, they put us on a bus, and I noticed the windows were always pasted with paper, so we couldn't look out and people couldn't look in. And took us to a town where there was a train waiting, and we noticed all the windows were plastered with papers. We were given $36 apiece to live on until we found a job. And if you remember during World War II, everybody was making money in these defense factories. So we had no trouble finding menial jobs that we were able to manage. The parents, however, were released right after the war ended. So they stayed in, what, 2 or 3 years longer. There was no time to feel anything. Mm-hmm. Just kind of surviving from day to day because, you know, if you could imagine going to some foreign place and you don't know where you're going to live, you have no friends, no relatives, you don't know what's going to happen. Mm-hmm. You know, feeling, I think, is a luxury. So I was able to get a job in Evanston as a nurse's aide. And while I was there, I decided that I wanted to go to nursing school, and I had Cook County Hospital in mind. and finally got into a Cook County School of Nursing. And just to show you how naive I was, when I went to Cook County, the patients were all black. And I said, well, why is everybody black? And I didn't know at that time, and some of you may not know, the whole city of Chicago was segregated. Since when I was accepted at Cook County, they limited to 3 Japanese Americans. So I was one of the lucky 3 to be picked, because evidently they had quite a few Japanese American applicants. Not only that, you know, in those days you think that was bad, at least they accepted 3 of us. No blacks were allowed. At that time, Cook County was almost 99.9% of the patients were all black, and yet the School of Nursing wouldn't admit. There was no question even asked. It was just assumed that no blacks could enter the College of Nursing, and that was the way it was in those days. I was in school during the war from 44 to 47. So we were all enrolled in this nurse cadet corps by the government, and we were given this uniform. It was just like a soldier's uniform. And all our tuition was paid by the government. And they gave us $35 in spending money with the promise that after we graduated, we would join the Army and become Army Nurse Corps. Well, as it turned out, the war ended. But nevertheless, let us keep the uniforms and kept paying us till we graduated. There was no specific program as a cadet nurse. Mm-hmm. You just stayed at your original hospital, right? And at Cook County, just to show you, after 6 months, we had what's called a candle ceremony. And after 6 months of training, we were assigned to night duty. And if any of you know Cook County, in those days there were no private rooms. There was this huge hall in which 80 beds side by side. And those of us with 6 month education were put in charge of 80 patients. So talk about experience. We had class all day the next day. They just kept us on nights because that freed the regular paid nurses. They didn't have to work nights. Well, at that time, we really didn't think we were told to do that, and that was it. I mean, we weren't taught to think deeply about the effects of what we're doing or what the patient might think. We had a room called the dying room or the death room. Besides the long wards, there were several rooms in which we put patients that were about dying. And on midnight rounds, the main thing we did was whether they were dead or alive. And we used to tear off the sheets on the bottom of the room and touch their feet to see whether it was cold or still warm, which designated which they were dead or alive. Patients that came to Cook County is usually as a last resort. They were just lucky to get a bed. Just a place for them to come in. If they recovered, they were lucky, and mostly somebody will look after their body if they died. So I graduated from Cook County Hospital, and I became a registered nurse back in 1948. Having kids and raising them, but after a while I got bored, you know, so I figured the best thing to do is get a little more education, right? Mm-hmm. So, you know, there's a will, there's a way. You decide you're going to do something and you do it. We lived in a city called Miller in Gary, Indiana, because we wanted to raise our kids in a suburb and not in a busy place like Chicago. But I started taking correspondence courses from Indiana University and took all the basic courses. And then when the last child went to school full-time, I started commuting to DePaul University here in Chicago from Gary and got my bachelor's and master's degree. But we're talking about the days where there were no PhD programs for nurses. So if you wanted to increase your knowledge, like I went on to get a master's in education in addition to a master's in nursing, because there was no way that was the best they had to offer in those days. The idea of nurse practitioners came out of Los Angeles, and there was an article saying they proved that nurses could do physical exam using all the instruments that the doctors use, and that appealed to me. Yes, when I was working for the school system, because while the children were still in school, and being a school nurse, I was out all summer along with the children, and that's where I heard about the nurse practitioner program. So I decided, oh, that sounds real good. So I petitioned the Board of Education in Gary, and I said, you need a nurse practitioner, and I'm the one who will be the nurse practitioner. So off I went to Denver, and they covered all my expenses, and by golly, I was a nurse practitioner. And I was in the first class at University of Colorado back in 1971. They were still experimenting to see whether nurses had enough brains to do the physical exam that the doctors did. And evidently were smart enough to do it. So then they started regular nurse practitioner courses. It was a 1-year course, but we only had to be there physically 4 months. But when I got back to the school system, and as nurse practitioners, they teach you how to do some developmental testing. And one of the psychologists there caught me doing that. And he got very angry. But smart me, I said, wait, you're the professional. I'm not a professional psychologist. You do the diagnosing. I'm only checking. And that made him happy. And I kept doing the testing. I thought, of course we're smart enough. So that was my expectation. But interestingly enough, you know, we needed mentors. Well, of course, there were no nurses out there to mentor us. So we were required to spend the rest of the 9 months attached to some doctors who would put up with us. Let me tell you, I had a hard time finding a doctor who was willing to take me in his office for 9 months. But I finally found one and practiced with him. And he was sure glad to have me because he was able to see almost twice as many patients. And his income went way up. Nurses traditionally have never, quote, advertised how good we were or how useful we are. But this nurse practitioner is to me is very gratifying because it was just in the Tribune the other day about how, especially in the suburbs, our Walgreens drugstore and many of the other places had opened up clinics staffed by one nurse practitioner, and which is a big money saving for the consumers because it's like at the most they pay $50 per visit, very accessible, and to a place where they don't have to go out of their way, and the parking is available. I mean, little things like that makes a big difference. So I think nurse practitioners are making a huge impact. The kids all left for college, then Sam and I decided, you know, we wanted a little more action, so we moved back into Chicago. as a final exam, they all had to go out and do a complete physical on one young person and a senior citizen. And invariably, the senior citizen would say, this is the first time in my entire life that somebody gave me a complete physical. And I feel so good about it. Why can't we have this from Japanese doctors? That's the response we get. So we know that. That's what the consumers want. You know, the boomers on the one hand seem like very frivolous, but I have to admit that there's some points to their attitude about let's do something about it. It may be all talk, but it's true. Now, the nursing home is a good example that we've just sort of gone along with the status quo, and then all of a sudden these quote smart alecky boomers come along and say, wait a minute, you know, what's wrong with this? And so I'm thinking, yeah, they have a point there. The kind of things let go by, you know, just because it's always been that way. I think we had a tendency of just looking the other way. We were forced to change our rigid requirements, and I think that's having a good effect. The graduate program in nurse practitioner was one of the best steps that the college took. And also the nurse practitioners are in different areas of nursing. And I think that they should really support these individual clinics that are sprouting up. And they're all in the suburbs. And I understand there's none in the inner city where that is certainly would be beneficial. And I just wondered to myself, how is it that the suburban areas were able to start that and there's nothing in the inner city? One thing that bothers me is that the applicants for nursing schools are really down. And I'm wondering, is there some legislation in Illinois where the government is willing to pay free tuition? Nursing was a big opportunity, whereas that is not true today. The young females have too many other options. So I'm wondering what we could do to change that view. But right now I feel helpless about that because indeed, there are other professions to go into. I'm not too good at having to negotiate and trying to get my way, but, you know, sometimes it's necessary.
Why did it?
It wasn't a question of liking or wanting to do. I just sort of kind of fall into these different things, you know? And whatever they say, I say, well, okay. The kids tease me about it, but from way back when they were kids, evidently, I started saying, I want to die with my boots on. Kids, they said they wonder what in the world is going on with mom, you know. But that's been my whole attitude all my life. I want to die with my boots on.